Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Top Cult, and today we bring you part two of our SAWtrospective. In SAW 4, a man we've never met's life is at risk, while an impulsive police officer learns not to burst through doors. Donnie Wahlberg stands on a block of ice.
At this point, things start getting chaotic in the franchise, so we figured the fourth movie would be a good time to go with some Warheads Extreme Sour. Based on a childhood favorite Warheads candy, it has enough flavor of the candy you know and love, with just enough sour to kick your ass a bit.
Once again, cheer?
Yes. One cheer this time.
One cheer this time. One cheer, left stomp.
Different movie, same beer, same stupid catchphrase from you.
Exactly. See, I didn't even say it.
I caught you to it.
Yep. Saw 4. Saw 4 is when we go wildly off the rails.
Yeah.
We have some characters that we started with in, that we were introduced to in 2, right? And we use those as the main components for the story going forward now. We have
for a couple movies, yeah.
Right. We have the Black Eye Rig is a cop who famously just runs into scenarios that he shouldn't.
Well, famously as in this movie.
Right, right. But well,
they establish it now.
They've established, you've been doing this your whole life, is barging right into doors when you shouldn't, so.
We know.
That's now, the direction. Now we know. Although he wasn't part of that crew that barged in that got their ankles
no
messed up.
No. So what's the story there?
Yeah, I don't know.
He hung back?
I guess so.
Okay. In that one moment, he knew it was bad.
Right.
But so, any other time.
Every other time, he's barged into open doors.
When it's story convenient.
Right.
Exactly. And from there, we are also introduced to the idea that we've spent a full movie away from toxic masculinity, Eric Matthews. And we've been revealed that he's still alive and hanging out.
Just chilling.
He's playing Nintendo.
That's just playing Nintendo, exactly. Cock. And that's all he does this movie. He must have been paid a lot of money.
It was a very easy paycheck for him.
Oh my God.
Well, maybe with the exception of the ending. Because he got his head crushed.
He has one line before he has his
How
head crushed.
How much do you think was done by a stand-in or a double?
Could have been the whole movie. I mean, anytime that there's not a close-up on his face.
It's true.
Yeah.
It's very true.
I kind of feel like he was there for maybe 2 days, and then they said, all right, that's a wrap on Donnie, and they sent him home.
I would be surprised if it was one day. It really, you just need close-ups.
That could have been
him
you.
To yell. Yeah.
That could have
easily
been you.
You could have totally shot that from the top of my head with a shitty
with
fucking wig. Yeah. That easiest paycheck probably ever. Yeah. He just has to yell, who the fuck's coming through that door, right?
No, don't come through that door.
Don't come through that door. And
don't
then
get it
that's
wrong.
That's a wrap.
Don't get it twisted.
Right,
don't get it twisted pictures.
Right. As we're above, we don't die. Serial
killers, we don't die.
Nice. So he's not even awake for most of the movie.
No.
You don't even see who it is, and we have a very silly wig on him. So that's forward over his face while he naps standing up most of the movie. The story here is Jigsaw wants Detective Rig to see what he sees and feel what he feels and all these things. And he's essentially trying to recruit him, making him understand the reason why Jigsaw is Jigsaw. You have some solid traps in this one, too.
Yeah. And even that concept is a very interesting concept.
It is.
I mean, granted, like, this is the first time where it really feels like he's trying to build up a protege instead of finding one.
Right. Falling into his lap.
Right.
Yeah, just like,
here
oh,
you
hey,
are.
You survived my trap. Okay, here you go.
Right. Exactly. And so I like that idea. And this is an introduction into how Jigsaw does convert people into seeing things his way and then doing, you know, his bidding. We have no more Amanda at this point. We have another detective has been stolen. Mr. Hoffman, who sits in a chair also with a gag over his mouth, doesn't say anything. We don't know him.
Yes. Well, that's the problem. We don't really know him that well.
Never met him.
That's a big issue, I feel like, in this movie.
Yes. This movie really suffers from pacing. Yes. And being completely convoluted.
Yes.
Having way too many things going on at once.
And also, I feel like the way the game was played itself was very weird because, like, the person was outside of the realm of the game. Like, he was in the outside world going from place to place.
Right.
And it just seemed just out of the ordinary for the series. I guess they were trying something different.
Yes.
But it just didn't seem like as confined. Like,
no.
Right.
Why wouldn't he contact anybody in the authorities of some way or do something else to like, you know, oh, hey, this is going on. Because he's going from place to place.
Right.
Right.
What is he doing in between these going to these places? You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it seems too easy for that to kind of just slip through.
Right. And I don't even think there's really stakes for him.
Ultimately, no.
His family hasn't been taken or anything. No. Right. He wants to beat Jigsaw's game, it seems like.
Good luck.
Yeah. Yeah. Me. Simple instructions. And there's little traps here and there that are very silly. He saves...
Well, the hair pull, the hair pulling ones first.
Yes, that's what I'm thinking of.
Was she a prostitute or no?
I think so. Yeah,
yes. She's a prostitute. Yes.
Not that it's a bad thing. Hey, if it's your...
She had an OnlyFans.
If it's your occupation. So OnlyFans is very prevalent right now.
Right.
I'm an advocate of, like, you know, prostitution worker. Movies. Right. Like Frankenhooker.
Yes.
Frankenhooker fucking rocks. Yes.
But like, it was one of those things that, like, it was a interesting trap, like, in theory.
Right.
Like, and it was gnarly seeing her hair going back.
In theory, yeah.
It's fitting for the message, which is supposed to be him saving somebody, but then seeing how they look at things drastically
well,
different.
Well, this very much becomes the movie that is... I would argue the death trap movie. Yeah. Like, even more so than 3. I still feel like there's enough in 3 to be about Amanda and the relationship.
Right.
And then Lynn coming in and that dynamic of him previously having those tests at the hospital, that whole element.
There's no real background story to this.
No.
Right. It's other just like, than, this is the traps.
Other than, like, the cops trying to figure out what's going on behind the scenes.
Right.
But, like, when it comes to Rig, there's no real, like, connection other than being a background character in the last 2 movies.
Yeah.
Also, that dude totally kills that hotel manager. He's just murders
him.
Oh,
that's right. Yeah.
But I think it's one of those things, like, he's trying to show him 2 different things. Like, he got punished for saving the girl because she tried to kill him afterwards.
Right.
Right.
So, like, I think it's, like, Jigsaw's trying to say you shouldn't have to save everybody, and just let things run its course.
Uh-huh.
Even with the hotel manager guy, he was given the choice to still live,
right?
Technically,
right.
But he had to put the things through his eyes.
Yes,
right.
So all he did was put him in the trap.
Yes, but which still is.
I mean, it's screwed up. It's very screwed up.
But I like from that point here, like. It's a good attempt at training somebody to follow in your footsteps if you're a Jigsaw. Where it falls apart is the ending.
Yes.
Yeah.
Where everything comes together, which all the other movies have done in the past, way more successfully. And I feel like while they're writing it, they're really not inspired by anything new.
Yeah.
Interesting idea to bring everybody together.
Well, that, and this is how it gets, like, super convoluted with all the twists and turns, especially now that Jigsaw's dead.
Yes.
You know, John Kramer is dead.
Oh, start with Jigsaw Dom. It's a murder on the dance floor, but you better not kill the
groom. Hey. Yeah, we do start with...
Jigsaw
How could we forget about Jigsaw Hug?
Right.
But, like, that's the thing. The interesting part of the movie is we start Was it that first trap first, right? Or was it John Kramer's
I think it's just
autopsy.
We just get right into Jigsaw Hog. Like,
yeah. That was the one thing that I wanted to tweet Boozman about. I was like, is that a stunt hog or is that Tobin Bell's hog?
I mean, it's a very need to know question.
Can you let us know?
Call us now, please.
but we love Mother's Day.
Yes.
To go back to Mother's Day. Yeah. There's no stunt hog there.
But. No stunt hog in Mother's Day.
Does this ever happen to you?
Yeah. But like, it was an interesting like thing. Like, okay, we're just proving that Jigsaw is dead. There's a whole autopsy and everything else. And they show Hoffman in the beginning finding that tape in him.
Right.
It's in his stomach, if I remember correctly?
Yes.
Something like that, yeah.
But like, it's just a weird thing to connect him to the story later on. Because he really, again, you don't really know Hoffman.
Like the only thing that ties back to the movie before that, because you don't know when at the end of the movie you do see at the end of three you see Jigsaw pouring candle wax on a tape and then eating it.
Yeah,
and that doesn't come into play. There's no
context.
Right.
So I guess there is a connection where they like they wanted to give themselves a direction to go in if they were going to make a four.
Yes.
I would love to know how much of this was planned from each movie forward. Like, how much of it did they say this would be four if we got the budget for it?
Way
this
more would than be the five. New Star Wars trilogy.
Probably.
I don't know about that.
Somehow Palpatine returned.
I
don't fucking know about that.
I don't think any of them were on the same
See,
page.
To go all the way back to the first movie and Zep there, they were writing Lost as they went along.
Yeah. Right.
And it suffers because at the end, the ending for me, I'm going to get canceled. Fuck you, Damon Lindelof. I'm done with you.
Come on, let's tear it down, Charlie.
Let's just rip it off the wall.
Rip it right off the wall.
Guys, I got a pocket knife. Just cut it out of the frame.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
There we go, because I've had enough of this, dude.
There's no impact.
Yes.
There's no impact.
No.
And so that whole, you know, purgatory, they were dead the whole entire time. That means nothing because you were writing the story as you went along. So I wonder how much of that was planned with Saw. If, like, at the end they went, oh, okay, based on what Jigsaw did right here, this is what four would be. But then by six, it's so convoluted because passed along somebody
else. I feel like once they got to four, they started really just like riding by the seat of their pants, just riding it as long.
But then I feel,
like the three, I think they just wanted to give themselves an out with the tape that he swallowed, just in case they wanted to do it. Because that was really the only major thing. Because three seemed like a very good closing entry the series if they wanted to go that route.
So James Bond's like, no, it's done, and somebody's like, but
there's so much money.
But you signed off the rights, so.
He walked off and somebody picked up scripts like he swallows a tape and then like put it back down.
So we get the autopsy scene and then we get the trap between the lawyer and the guy who was blind. One of the guys had his eyes thrown shut.
His mouth thrown shut. Oh, that's a good trap.
That's a great trap.
That's a good trap.
And then
they do see no evil, hear no evil.
Yes.
Thing.
Right, yeah. Right. And they're both being pulled into the center there.
I forgot there was four.
Yeah. And then it was super brutal, like him beating him, what was it?
With a hammer.
Yeah.
Fucking holding him over.
And then
he screams and then that shit rips open. Yeah. Oh, that's a good scene.
Great trap. Great setup. Like, that's great. Very good opening
part of the movie. Right. And then you get Saw 4. That's the first thing you see. That's really good.
Then you get Hog. Or is
then
Hog
you get Hog. No, then you get
I'm
Hog.
I'm glad that we figured this out.
Yep.
We traced back the Hog.
Inquiry minds need to know.
Yes. Yeah. It's really important.
But like overall though, it just felt like the story and everything else just was just kind of there to just give people traps.
Yes.
There was no, even with Riggs, there wasn't really any emotional connection. They tried to do it with the, like, you know, they're showing his flashbacks and stuff like that. Right. Like, oh, you know, like, there's this, the teacher, I guess it was a teacher that was like,
yes.
Yeah.
That was like,
yes.
Oh. And what, like, he was talking to the little girl and like, you know, like, oh, is this guy abusive?
Right. Creepy pedophile,
whatever route they were going. I don't think they mentioned it. They just alluded to it.
Right.
But yeah, like they were showing like him reacting in certain thing. So they did a better job than Jeff in 3 of making him more personal. You know,
it's not hard.
Not hard. No, you definitely have a more likable protagonist.
Right, right, yes.
But
yes.
Overall, like, they just, you know, he just went from trap to trap to trap.
Right.
And then there's police procedural behind it, which really goes nowhere. They don't really find anything.
But see, that's the thing is that, like, I feel like this police procedural is better than it is in 2.
Oh, well, it definitely is, because they don't really do anything in 2. They just talk.
They sit there.
Yeah.
They just sit there and talk.
And watch monitors.
Although, with that, it gives you, the way they did it in 2 lets you know more about the character Jigsaw himself.
Right.
Which
you
don't
really learn in 1. Right. And you really learn his true motives in 2. I feel like that's really what comes out.
They just kind of figure, like, you know enough now, we don't need to elaborate upon it.
Yeah. Right. Well, yeah, that's the thing, is 2 is at a standstill, because there's nothing to figure out. Everything's here, and you need to stay in this moment. If you don't, you're fucked.
For sure.
So, but yeah, about 4, about the police procedural aspect of 4, it's very, we call it the Scatman Crothers aspect, where
I was wondering where that was going.
Yeah,
I wasn't just sure where you were going either.
It's just written to stall and to take away time.
Yeah.
You know, it's something to get you from point A to point B.
Well, again, I don't, like, they just wanted to get to the Hoffman reveal.
Yes.
Right.
Exactly. They didn't know exactly how to do that. So they took a secondary character from one of the movies. Well, 2 of the movies, I guess. I think he's in 2 of them.
Yeah.
And
he's, like, the only one left of those characters. So, like, okay, we might as well put you through all the traps.
Right. It's very evident that that's the shortcoming of the movie.
Yeah.
And then we'll give Eric Matthews or Donnie Wahlberg the biggest check ever to come back for a brief cameo.
Right.
And put his life on the line in a weird contraption that had him standing on an ice block.
Right.
And over water. And then, like, you know, hanging. And then
the, also getting electrocuted.
The seesaw thing.
Right. There is something in Spiral, though, that we'll talk about later that I feel like Saw 4 does better with Donnie Wahlberg than they do in Spiral.
Okay. I'm intrigued. Well, we'll get there.
Yeah. We'll get there. Yeah. So, Donnie Wahlberg, very, like, if he had any pride at all, there's no reason for him to come back and film that.
But the money talks.
Good on Wahlburgers wasn't opened yet. Okay. They didn't have the reality show yet.
This is true. This is very accurate.
Right.
But, like, the whole message to Rig was, do not barge into situations. Do not be do not be a hero. Do not be, you know, do all these things.
Which so, is like police training, like 101. Don't do that.
You shouldn't barge through doors without checking what's going on. Right. With backup or anything like that.
Right.
But hey. But that's ultimately what it leads to towards the end.
Yes.
The whole reveal and everything else. But it's a very over the top, convoluted ending.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It just gets confusing, and it just, like, it just happens so fast. You're, like, wondering, like, what the hell is going on? And then all of a sudden, Hoffman reveals himself.
Who directed 4?
It was Gosman still.
Was it? Shit.
Okay, so we were talking about this earlier.
So 5 is when he jumps off then. Okay.
So I almost can't believe that it's Bowsman or Boozman or whatever.
I don't fucking care.
It's technically Bowsman.
Your Mother's Day remake is really good.
I've heard friends of him call him Bowsman.
Okay. So I couldn't believe that it's Bowsman, because there's some really terrible shots in this movie that are brand new to the series.
But I mean, when you think about it, he really doesn't. I'm going to talk shit about him. He doesn't have great shots, always.
No, but there's, like, weird stuff in
Although
this
I think he did better on Spiral.
He definitely has a better understanding of color in that. But even, like, his Mother's Day remake, he has really weird shots in that, where you look at fucking Karen Page's character.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, like, cut in a very bizarre way. And I'm like, did you do this? Or did the person who was your assistant do this?
Right.
So it doesn't surprise me if that's, like, you have a problem with that shot.
Well, no, that could also depend on the editor.
Right.
But, the shots
but
I'm
like
talking
the way
about,
that's framed.
True.
But
so I guess we're never getting Darren Bowsman as a guest here.
No.
Sorry, mate. Sorry. Hey, I love your Mother's Day.
We've been praising the shit out of his movies, honestly. Way more so than I
enjoy him much more than she does. So let me. So if you ever want to go to Beer, Blood, and Bodyslams, there's still an opportunity there, my friend.
So there's a few shots that are really laughable that come when somebody gets thrown through a glass window. And,
yeah,
and
that's
bad. That transitions into just like people hanging out at a police precinct.
It's so weird. Like it's so unnecessary. It's so in the middle of the movie.
Right.
And there's like not many other cuts that are like that.
No, it completely
so, like,
takes
why did you do that?
Right, exactly.
I wonder how much of it is also looking back on
right,
how
you're just frustrated and just going through the motions at that
right.
point.
That and also studio interference. Like
course,
we
yeah.
have to hit XYZ right. and you need to get to this point and that's the time that you have.
Or yeah. maybe like a second AD or something like that, you know? Yeah. Like somebody that wanted to really put their mark on it. Mm. Like, ooh, wouldn't
like
it be cool if
this
happened? And he's
Mate.
Already like Bowsman's already fucking
he's
gone
done.
At that point.
He's like,
see,
bye.
we're still okay. You're
we
like,
love you so much.
Hang out. We're good. Hang out.
Make another movie with Rebecca De Mornay.
But overall, I feel like the traps were fine, but like you know
that one with the sex pervert teacher
yes.
and his wife
yeah.
that was a very cool
a
like
time.
Dual trap.
That's a good. That's awesome. That's
yeah.
good
yeah.
stuff.
And it put it on her like that kind of rung back to like the more old school traps in terms of like
yes.
yeah
okay you have to decide your fate.
Well yeah, there's a metaphor in the trap itself.
Yes,
and that's really fitting for a jigsaw trap.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember if it's this movie because we watched all of these.
They blur.
But
they
do blur. There was a Native American with a fucking like Disturbed piercing and he had to rip all the shit out. Was that this movie or was that Five?
I think that might have been five.
I think that was the intro to Five.
Yeah.
Really? Okay.
I think so.
Okay.
I don't think that's Four.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the traps all seem in Four winnable. Am
yeah.
I wrong about that?
Yeah. Well, yes, because the girl with the hair.
That's what I was going to say.
She needed help
right.
from Rig.
And he needed to kill her.
But the thing is, he was punished for not, you know,
right.
for saving her.
That right. was the one that I thought
which
that...
Which is a weird dynamic. That's why I think this is more Hoffman's game than anything else.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't care who lives and dies. Although, like, the pervert, well... You know, the pervert guy at the bed, the hotel manager.
Yeah.
He had the option because he just had to lose his eyes.
Right.
I mean, not great. You could
but,
very easily still die that way.
Right.
I want to take what you just said and introduce this, though. Why did Adam need to die? Dr. Gordon had to kill Adam, right? That was his trap.
Yes.
Did he kill Adam? His goal was to kill Adam.
Yeah.
Your goal is to kill Adam.
Oh, yeah, but he never did.
No, but that's how he wins that game, is murdering this other person. But why did Adam need to die?
That's...
Death is
so
sad,
why is
but
that,
it happens.
I think, why is that any different
I think
than
the, test was,
the girl with the hair?
I think the test was more so that he needed to prove that, like, even though he was given the option to kill Adam to get out, he wasn't going to do it. That's the test.
But what if he killed Adam? What if he just had a fucking...
Then he's... You
game over.
Game over.
But then, as in he wins. He gets let go, right?
No, I don't think so.
But also, Jigsaw destroyed a bunch of ankles.
Yeah, he did. Just turned him
sometimes
into mashed potatoes.
Sometimes it just happens.
To be fair with all these movies, as fun as they are and everything else, you can overanalyze them to death.
Right.
Which we love doing.
There's always going to be holes.
Oh, for sure. Of course.
You know, it's impossible. Like, even like, the plot holes are in the first one that are, they kept on trying to fix in the later sequels.
Yes.
You know, it's still, there's still plenty of holes. There's still
I think there. What we discussed earlier that could totally rewind back to with Jigsaw, that is the flaw in Jigsaw's logic and philosophy.
Yeah.
Is there is still something wrong with him that he doesn't see something like that.
Yeah.
That glaring issue. So, yeah. But going back to Four, for the most part, everything. I think it works as a prequel to Five.
That's the thing. Like, as the Four, Five, and Six, it's the Hoffman trilogy.
Right.
I mean, it kind of works.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we'll get more into Five once we get into Five.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, because a lot we have to say
that's
about
a good
Five.
Plan.
But we can actually talk about the movies when we're actually during the certain movie,
right?
Overrated. One of the things though that when we're talking about Jigsaw not being necessarily logical or his moral code going against it. We haven't talked about Jigsaw being a wife guy yet.
True.
And that is a big component of it, as we see later on, is that
John Kramer is wife guy.
Jigsaw is a wife guy.
Yeah, that's true. We didn't even, yeah, we didn't talk about it.
I mean, like, well, I'm pretty sure Jill is introduced in, is it she introduced?
It's four,
in
yeah.
Was it four? No.
I think it's four.
No. Jill is in...
She's
in
three?
Yes, you're right. You're right. Jill is introduced in four.
Yeah.
Jill is introduced in four. Because Jill, they give the idea
the right
that
time.
Hoffman made Amanda fuck up Jill's pregnancy.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Right?
Wait, something like that.
Wait, Hoffman made it? I don't even remember
yeah.
that.
Yeah. This might be in five. I'm pretty sure it's in five. Could be in four. Could be in four, totally, because... I don't really remember how much
they blend.
Makes up. Yeah, so Hoffman says he knows about Amanda's traps that are killing people.
Mm.
So he says you and the crackhead need to fuck up the pregnancy.
No, but that's the prequel before everything, though.
Oh,
so
wait.
Hoffman's not even involved in that.
Oh, no. I'm sorry. I got it wrong.
Yeah,
I got it wrong. You're right. Here's what it is. Hoffman knows Amanda was part of the crackhead.
Yes. John Kramer
killing
didn't
the
know,
baby.
John Kramer didn't know that.
Right.
Or maybe if he did, he didn't.
So Hoffman used that as blackmail to make Amanda shoot Lynn.
Yes.
That's
right.
What it was.
Yes.
Okay.
There we go. Back to
all right.
There we go.
We
We're
need
good.
Like a scientist man timeline. For
right,
this
right, right, right,
right. No, we have too much, there'd be too much
yeah,
written.
Yeah.
No.
Our Impedigore short one's coming soon. No, it's not.
Just wait. I'm editing it.
Oh, God.
Okay, yes. But that's Saw 4.
But overall, like, there was parts were enjoyable, but overall it was very by the numbers, I thought.
It just leads you to the end.
Which, this is yeah. where the decline starts to yes. happen in the whole mm-hmm. franchise, yes. yeah.
It, this is all paid by numbers at this point. To introduce your new villain. And
yeah,
that's
really the whole purpose of the movie was.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then, like, up until, you know, the rest of it, it's really just...
How dare you? No, there's some great
I'm
shit
not saying
that,
I'm not saying there's not, you know, a good movie in there.
Okay,
you know,
okay,
to,
okay, go ahead.
You know, we'll get there.
Yes,
we'll get there.
Yes, yes.
But, like, it's just very going by the motions the
yes.
rest of the way.
I completely agree. I think, yes.
Absolutely.
So far... Probably one of the weakest in the series.
Yeah. Okay. I agree.
Saw 5 coming up next.
You gotta save yourself. My work will continue.
In Saw 5, Agent Strom, with his newly destroyed vocal cords, tries his best to hunt down Jigsaw's newest protege. We learn about Jigsaw's past and why it's important to listen to the entire tape. Julie Benz plays a game that no one cares about.
Next, we keep going sour, but with something sweeter. Sweet as a grandma's kiss, with Grandma's Kisses Blueberry Sour. Great blueberry flavor that you'll be waiting for its next visit.
And we're back.
For better or worse.
Yes.
Now,
this brings us to Saw 5. And with Saw 5, we think, what an appropriate time to bring ourselves into drinking something else out of something else.
Yeah, we switched it up a little bit.
New movie, new drink.
Yes. There you go. Also, within the franchise, I think, an appropriate position to kind of transition there. But we have a nice Mina Mesa Cabernet, which is honestly like a really great time.
Yeah.
Go for it.
It's not expensive either.
Yeah. No. And in these glasses that you will notice are very apropos.
I guess I didn't earn a glass yet.
No, I'm sorry.
It's the same thing with the spirals. I couldn't get
You gotta kill another protege.
Gotta kill a protege, man.
Watch your back, Kyle.
I'm gonna have to, man.
But Mercedes over at New Moon Creation Shop on Etsy did these for Kyle for his birthday. I wish I fucking recorded his reaction to them because she personalized them. They're absolutely incredible. Red glitter at the bottom for all of the blood in the world.
Yep.
Please give her your money. She's incredible and she does a ton of different stuff, a ton of different colors. Give her your money.
Yeah, mine says, hello, Kyle. I'd like to play a game, so.
You cannot stop smiling.
Yes, for sure. So, Saw 5, guys. This is the second in the Hoffman trilogy.
Yes.
I would say...
So it's the, like, the last Jedi of the Hoffman
trilogy? Yes. But yes, but no, because this is a really bad movie. And there's way more enjoyable things in The Last Jedi than Saw 5.
People would disagree with you about that, but also... Let's just
You're not wrong though.
No, some really bad and then some really good.
But let's also just admit that like Star Wars exists to make people mad now and that rocks.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
That's really good.
I like when people get mad. That's really funny to me. So, yeah, Saw 5, Hoffman's New Hope, right?
Sure.
He we're revealed that he's the bad guy, and I think this is actually probably the movie where we go into all of the backstory stuff with him and Amanda.
Well, that's the thing. This movie is known for being the very backstory-driven film, more so than the group with the traps.
Right.
And it kind of takes over the film in a negative way, completely, in my opinion.
Yeah, this is one of the first ones where the traps are completely secondary to the story going on, and that's the main focus, is the backstory.
But it's almost like the movie doesn't know that. Like, they keep carrying on in a way where traps are happening, and then by the end of that point, it's like, oh, we forgot that this whole other thing was happening.
Oh, God, this is the Julie Benz movie.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. They're filling
in hate this movie. Yeah.
They're filling in all the plot connections and stuff like that. Right. This is really when Julie Benz...
This... shits the bed so hard. I'm getting mad now that I'm remembering that that's this movie. Okay.
That wig is really bad.
Anytime Julie Benz wears a black wig,
you drink.
She massacres a movie. Let the body sit the throat. 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 It's... She destroyed this movie, but the movie was dying a horrible death before she had anything to do with it. But Punisher Warzone, black wig, Julie Benz, terrible time. Probably, I don't really remember, but Boondock Saints 2, All Saints Day.
Oh shit, that's right.
Probably does have a black wig. Probably her fault. Probably terrible.
Yeah, probably her fault.
I don't have a problem with her in Dexter.
No,
blonde. I think she's
Dexter did. Dexter as a show did it to itself.
It did.
But she's also.
I don't know what's going on with everybody. She is also a blonde
in that show.
Yeah, exactly.
So do you think it's just a matter of like blondes are okay, but people with dark black hair? No,
I think it's that she wore the black wig. And she goes, well, now I need a New York accent now.
That is.
She has to like overcompensate for her not being a real hair color.
Yeah, right. It's because she's self conscious about it.
Like, this is what I have to do to make myself a character.
Right, and it's, oh, dude.
Now I'm real actor, thespian.
Yes.
Right.
So, the traps in this movie are completely forgettable. They don't really make any sense at all. It's a free-for-all.
Well, the thing is, the thing I like about the traps is there's definitely a group dynamic to it, but they never really play that up until the end.
No.
And, like, it was an interesting way of doing it, but they could have done a lot better.
Yes. Well, that's the thing, is at no point can they can come to the realization that two people can fit in a tunnel or any other aspect. It's just, like, everybody at each other's throats the whole time. This is the first Buckethead trap, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, it was the collars.
Yeah.
Okay, so...
That was another thing.
How did they lose this?
What?
How do you lose this trap? This isn't the same thing as cut yourself a little bit and you're good. Like in Jigsaw, right?
This one was you had to reach for the keys.
Yeah.
So like as you pull forward for the keys, it brings the other people back.
Okay.
But like
so every person go one.
So if everyone was going at the same time, they would pull more people back.
Got it.
But if one person goes at a time, then it's not so bad. Right. You know?
Overall, though, I do feel like anything with a group dynamic, by the time this movie actually realizes that that's happening, all of those people are dead. Well, and yeah. Julie Benz is just there being like,
I won the game. I won the game.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. She delivers that line and you're like, what fucking game? Yeah. What movie is this?
Yeah. It didn't happen.
It's treated as such an afterthought.
Yeah.
And the movie heavily suffers because of that. The game doesn't matter at all. You don't know these people and there's really nothing at stake either.
No.
The most interesting character that would have been gets killed in the second trap where the pipe bombs explode and he was the only guy that knew anything about everybody.
Yeah, he was the one talking sense about everything and then all of a sudden that whole thing happened and then he's dead.
So he just died, which was your only guide to what's really going on with any of these people. And then we're just left with like Julie Benz with a black wig, probably New York accent, and a dude that scratches himself.
Yeah.
That's his whole character.
Yeah.
Yeah, like he was like a rich kid or whatever, right?
Right. And they're like, oh, what's wrong with you? He's like, oh, heroin. And like, that's just that, like, the whole
scratch.
Yeah, that's it. That was his whole character. Really nothing engaging at all. This was strictly just showing you Hoffman's been there the whole time, we promise. And also, he blackmailed Amanda because it turns out Amanda, while she was a junkie, was part of the reason why that other junkie smashed John Kramer's wife's belly with a door.
Right.
So John Kramer blackmailed.
He's a wife guy.
So he's wife guy, right. That's major in this movie, too.
Yeah.
Part two, John Kramer wife guy.
Wife guy. So Hoffman blackmails Amanda being like, you have to kill Leah. What's her fucking name?
Lynn.
Thank you. You have to kill Lynn. And so this brings us into a conversation about we're trying to figure out if Hoffman decided that he wanted to just be the new Jigsaw and not follow the rules and just do shit his way.
But then again, he's still following the rules of these games. So I like he's setting up the traps and doing everything. But then again, like some of the traps don't even later on don't seem very winnable.
No, exactly. And I think that's in this movie too.
Although this movie, it's a little bit more winnable with a group dynamic though.
Yeah,
because they were able to win all those traps.
Right.
But they just didn't because they're idiots.
Well, that's the thing. I don't think they realized what this movie was. Having a game going in real time while also showing you traps that happened before, that's where they fucked up because they're showing you traps that happened before that were unwinnable.
Yeah.
And then, like that's where you should be showing the traps. And that's your story. You don't need to have that and also this game that's happening now.
Mm-hmm.
And by doing that, You confused viewers on what to feel about what and when. This is where we get into murky water of, well, Hoffman demanded that Amanda shoot Lynn, which if she shoots Lynn, then that kills John Kramer.
Right.
So why go on doing his game for no reason?
Exactly. It's just plot holes that like they... Some of them they cover, but a lot of them they don't.
No.
Yeah.
So then that's not we're missing a motivation thing. Then it's just, oh, bad writing. Got it.
Yeah.
That's why we drink during these movies. We don't try to think during these movies. Right.
Yeah. I would say 5 is where it really starts to kind of blend together with what is this? And which is why we can't figure out where is the big wife subplot starting to happen.
I think it's definitely in this movie.
Yeah. No,
it's getting there. You know, she's getting more of a reveal here.
This is the inheritance thing. Yeah. It's more so than the fourth one where she's like just kind of there through flashbacks. The fifth one I think is where she actually goes to the lawyer and he says, hey, I have this tape for you.
Yeah.
Yes.
But we don't find out. But we don't find out until 6. So what was it? On everything.
Right.
Is that the case?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
They set it up, but they don't pay off during this movie.
Okay.
Also,
you're right.
Also, we are introduced to Strom.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Not Golden Girls. What is it?
Gilmore Girls.
He has his own coffee brand that I really want to try.
Yeah.
Not to go too far off because it's not like we've done that before.
You've been drinking espresso, so that's kind of the same.
It's fine.
Into wine now.
Yeah.
But yeah, Gilmore Girls, solid writing. Detective Strom.
That guy rocks.
Yeah, he's a cool guy.
cool guy.
Yeah, this movie is basically the problem with his character is he comes in and we now know Hoffman and we're now in a position where it's like, oh, Hoffman outsmarted everybody. And so this is your first movie following Hoffman, knowing who he is.
Right.
And so Hoffman's like, you're supposed to be led through this now, being like, oh, now we get to see him in a different perspective, knowing what's actually going on and seeing how he orchestrates it.
Yes.
But the problem with that is while we're now viewing how he orchestrates things with us being in on the joke also, or like in on what's going on, you have Strom being like, yeah, no, that don't make sense. That don't make sense. I don't think you should do that way. I think what's actually happening is this. And so it just like really cuts it off.
Well, they have to show that Strom's kind of on his tail a little bit.
Right.
Yeah.
And then like that's the point of the ending of it, which is more focused on them than it is the actual like traps and the group there. And
yeah.
Then, you know, that ending.
That's right. Because most of the focus of this movie is of Hoffman setting up Strom. Yeah. Right?
Right.
Or is that...
Well, no, not yet.
Or is that six?
No, that's six. this is more like Hoffman's doing his thing and then Strom shows up. And he starts ruffling feathers.
Right.
And then the end where he gets caught by Hoffman.
Right.
And put in his own trap.
This is the glass box.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, but this is the setting up of Strom. Because then that guy that really just wanted a best friend, Strom, he was like Strom's boy, but Hoffman started being like, hey, Peter, like, let's hang out.
Oh, you mean the captain guy?
Yeah, captain.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's wanted a friend, and Strom blew him off.
Right, and there's the folder and all of that. Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Right.
But yeah, but
because then he picks up the phone, he's like, oh, Jesus, Peter.
But that's not really until the sixth one, I don't think.
No, that's the ending of five.
Oh, that is the ending of five. Yeah. You're right.
Because that's in the glass box.
What's his first name?
Huh? It's Peter.
I was going to say,
Peter Strom.
It's Peter Strom. Like, I think his name is Peter.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So the other guy's name isn't Peter.
Yeah.
But it's something cool, probably. Like
Peter's a pretty cool name.
It's Christopher. I don't know. But it's hard to remember that guy's name or face. But here he is. I remember his face. He just wanted a friend. Yeah, that whole thing is setting up Strom.
Thank you for being a friend.
Yeah, that's...
We had that gimmick already.
Yeah. That's the problem with this movie, is that's the focus, and it knows it needs a twist in the end. And that's really it.
But there really is no twist.
Well, it's that he should have been in the box instead of the other guy.
Yeah.
Well, no, that's not this movie.
Yeah, it's five.
Is it five?
That's the end of five.
Oh, so Strom gets introduced to the four then.
Oh, shit.
We screwed up.
No, that's fine. That's we were saying that four is convoluted, and it's so convoluted that we don't even remember.
Take a drink.
Okay, fine.
Accept defeat.
We lost this game.
I could have.
I was thinking the same thing, and I was like, I don't think that six has any of Strom. I think that's just the healthcare debate. But then I'm like, I'll just go with this.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah,
you're right.
Nope.
Holy shit.
Could have spun this in a way that benefited us, but it's too late now.
No.
Strom introduced in four.
Yeah.
So, yes, back to four.
So, wait a minute. This is so cool.
And then he gets captured. So, I guess it's after the rig trap. He gets captured. Oh, he finds the...
I'm so lost.
He finds the part from three. He finds the surgical area.
Right, right.
From three.
That's all happening at the same time.
And then he...
That's right, because the end is that reveal. Yes.
But the ending of four...
He gets locked in there. And the beginning of five...
Strom gets locked in the room.
Strom's locked in the room. So,
while Hoffman rises.
But he finds a secret door. He goes out and then gets captured.
Right.
Gets put in that water trap.
Right. Because five is more of his journey.
I thought this was
that's
six.
Right. Yes. No. And then he comes out and then he has the rehabilitation with the voice. Yes.
Right.
That's
so
right.
Hoffman saves the day, brings out the little kid. Right, that's right. That's oh my god. That's
Jeff's. And here's the twist of this review video.
Yeah, that's Shithead Jeff's kid.
That we don't know what we're talking about all the time, the whole time.
Hoffman comes out with Shithead Jeff's kid, saves the day. Strom pokes a hole in his throat
and tries to act tough. And he thinks he's done.
Right, right.
And then he's like, oh, shit.
Right.
Hoffman thought he got rid of him.
Right.
And which is great because your protagonist can't talk now. So it's awesome.
So what I said about Strom getting close to it, that was in part four.
Yes.
And then, you know, part five is, you know, Strom basically knows the whole time. He just needs to find a way to prove it, really.
Right. Well, that's because he heard Strom's cadet got face punctured by the puppet.
Right. Right. Yes.
So he said, why did she say Hoffman? And that's how he sounds for the rest of the movie now.
You know what?
It's not great.
Yeah, it's way worse than the Red Eye Cillian Murphy. Yeah. I got the pencil in the throat.
Yeah.
I know you don't like Red Eye.
I don't. I hate it.
Hi, Andrew. How are you?
We'll talk about that
soon. I like Red Eye.
I like Red Eye too. I think it's a good time.
I think she should have just done what she was told if her father's life was at risk.
Yeah, but look at all of the Saw movies that you love where they don't listen to what they're told.
And then there's consequences.
And she had consequences too.
Nah, not really.
Yeah, she did.
Halfway through the movie when they slammed her head into the thing and then her back down.
She like murdered people in the hotel.
Nah, everything was fine.
Nobody's murdered.
Is it really though?
No, it was a bad movie.
Nah, Cillian Murphy rocks.
He's great. He's great, but that movie was bad around him. That's my opinion.
So basically now with five.
Yes.
Strom finally caught up. But this is also one of the good things about this movie, it has the badass scene where they find the recording from the the trap. I think it might be from the pendulum trap or like the.
Is
it from the puppet? Either way, that's how they find out that Hoffman is the Jigsaw killer.
Right.
But then, like, he kills them right as the voice thing happens. Like they find out, like the once the like,
that's five.
They're changing the voice thing.
No, that's six.
No.
Are you sure about this?
Pretty sure.
No, I think it's five.
No, I think that is five.
Yeah.
No. I don't think any of this is happening in six. No, I think six is just about healthcare.
Okay, no. Okay, here's the thing. Six ends with... Spoilers. Six ends with Jigsaw wife putting the trap on him.
Yes, so right. Yeah, that's her thing on him. Strom's not involved in that.
Yeah.
And Hoffman... Yes.
I don't think you watched it.
I don't know, man.
I could be wrong.
Should we look it up?
You are. No. This is too much fun.
We're already going off the rails.
This is way too much fun.
This is actually probably better than us actually knowing what we're talking
about. Exactly, yes. Yeah, that's the problem with all these. The Hoffman trilogy is it's hard to place which movies happen where. It is a quadrilogy because...
Really, the final chapter, too.
The final chapter.
Is a Hoffman.
Is a Hoffman movie.
Yeah.
Which I wish he had more of like a Joker Jigsaw... smile, but they really don't show him much in that next
movie. Yeah, that was the weird thing about that too.
It's like they spend all this time like fucking his face up and like you never see it.
No.
Yeah. Damn. Damn. I remember the exact moment we were talking about and it's badass. And that's why I think it happens in six and I think that's why I like six a lot.
Okay, you might be right. Oh, you know what? You're right.
Okay.
I'm wrong.
Hey, look at that.
Sorry, people. Sorry. He is correct. I just realized this. I need to drink more.
Yes, because five ends with a box.
Does it?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes, because he's trying to blame the murders on Strom.
Right.
Yeah.
See,
Strom's missing because he's dead.
Right.
But then, like, he puts the fingerprints on the...
Right, okay. Yeah,
okay, we're getting ahead of ourselves, but we're also very confused and... Slightly inebriated.
Yes, five ends with the box. Yes, we know this. This has to be true. Four ends with Strom being locked in the room, Hoffman getting up. Yes.
So I can take away that cool part that I thought was in five and six, so it makes five even worse movie for me.
Yes, exactly.
But
that's where we're all going back to.
Wait, what movie are we talking
five.
About, though?
We're on five.
Okay.
We're not on Spiral yet.
We're talking about the Hoffman quadrilogy.
I was like, I don't think we're talking about six.
No, but we had to clarify because I screwed up.
Yep. Because he mentioned a part that he loves.
We all fucked up.
Which happens to be in 6.
But it was fair to think it was in 5. Yes. Because we thought the other part was in 5.
Right.
Well, we thought the other part was in 4.
It's fine.
Well, no. Well, we thought, we thought it was in 5. Great. And we realized Strom came in 4.
Right.
Fantastic.
And this is an amazing rambling of like misinformation everywhere.
We're doing incredible.
Oh, it's so good.
But overall, Saw 5, not a great movie. Not really a fun time.
No.
Very boring. It's just very information filled.
Yeah.
And it just...
It's trying to tell you this is our excuse of trying to explain to you that Hoffman's been here the whole time. We promise. Right. Please take our word for
it. It's one of those movies that you're not going to care about unless you're like a severe fan of the franchise. Right. And you want to know about those characters.
Exactly. It's just trying to fill in the holes that were open during the rest of the series.
And then Gilmore Girls guy gets... is fucking
great. We love him.
He's a cute ending. He puts, well, that's probably the only good thing about the movie, really. That in the beginning, I guess.
Right.
Yeah.
The beginning was fine. But like the ending where he throws Hoffman in the box and then he gets crushed for it.
Right.
Hoffman throws Strowman. Oh, yeah.
Hoffman throws Hoffman because
that's the reveal.
Yes. So yeah, that's really it for that movie.
So Saw 6.
It's cute.
Let's get the Saw 6. Hopefully we get this one right.
Yeah. I think we will. That one's way more fun.
Well, I think we got covered all the other ones.
Yeah.
Have you learned enough to trust me?
In Saw 6... hotshot insurance executive William Easton must narrowly avoid killing everyone he knows, while super sneaky Jigsaw protege Detective Hoffman creates multiple bloodbaths of his own. Jigsaw teaches us why universal healthcare is super important.
We take a break from the sours with Pocket Wrench Pale Ale, a fluffy little New England pale ale that comes in at a quaffable 4.5 ABV and is loaded with new American hops.
So, this brings us to my personal favorite, Saw 6.
Is it your personal favorite?
Yeah, I don't think Saw 1 counts.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't think it counts?
No.
What do you mean, in the context of the movies?
Yeah, like...
I mean, obviously it does.
My favorite sequels, though.
Oh, well, the you didn't say that, though.
Oh, okay.
I mean, there's a difference.
Yeah, that's true. But it's up there with Saw 1 for me.
That's fair.
You know, it's a great time. Good characters, motivation's clear, it's not convoluted, you know, and it's the end of the Hoffman saga for the most part.
Well, because they got through all the bullshit from before that we were all confused with.
Right.
Right.
What are you talking about? We explained that perfectly.
So there, with the exception of like...
With
the exception of some little parts with Jill, they really were able to tell their own story with this one.
Yes.
And it was actually a very interesting one because it had a message. It was with the healthcare system.
Yes. Right. Yeah. And all that stuff lands well. You know, the dialogue's good for John Kramer meeting the head of the insurance company.
Well, right? You know, because they have to tie their way back in. So that you have the fact that he went to try to get insurance for his healthcare and he was denied.
Yes. Yeah, it fits well into the story of everything also, like timeline-wise. It's not something that just feels shoe-ended. And
no, not nearly as much as some of the other stuff was, for sure.
No, it makes sense to make that commentary within the whole thing that they've built up.
Yeah, with the franchise also, right. It
doesn't feel like, oh, this is just a message that we're trying to tie in now. Right. Like, it feels like they've been trying to build towards this in some way based on his moral code and all of that.
And I do believe it's the first time that we're shown of John Kramer's trap originally that started his entire new philosophy, where John Kramer gets into the car accident, gets Father's Day pierced through the ribs.
Right.
Right.
Oh, Ahab. You're hurt. No, I'm fine. It's out.
And then has to pull that shit out, has a new appreciation for life because of that.
Right.
which is definitely an appreciated addition to the legend of Saw.
Yes.
Let's see. We have a ongoing continuation of the protagonist going through these traps, needing to redeem themselves, being a piece of shit.
But this one, aside from, like, you know, how they did in 3, they with asshole Jeff.
Yes. Piece of shit.
Hashtag asshole Jeff.
This one, I mean, this guy's an asshole too, but they kind of show a little more growth through this one, I think.
Yes, completely.
Than the other one.
Yeah, definitely.
Asshole Jeff.
Yeah, that's what makes this movie way more successful also, is a character that works in this universe reacting to things as strongly as they should be.
Yeah. But also, like, that seemed like to be a very big focus. Like, the whole story of this was a very big focus of the movie, aside from, like, you know, how even in 3, it was like a little more focus on the with Lynn and John Kramer. And another side story.
Yeah.
Right. This is really, like, mostly focused on the game, and then there's just little bits in between.
Yes.
Of, like, you know, Hoffman and Jill.
But honestly, for the most part, yeah, everything really told in flashback. Mm-hmm. Other than those little bits of, like, Jill opening up a box or, like, carrying the box places and little things like that. And Hoffman just trying to cover tracks.
Well, that's the thing. And that's also actually pretty interesting, Hoffman covering tracks.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
You know.
All of this, like, boils down to, like, a really fun, exciting conclusion. When shit hits the fan, Hoffman realizes that people know who he is now. He just, like, lays waste to everybody and everything.
So this was the part I was trying to talk to everyone about before.
Yes.
That I thought was in 5, but it's in 6, because I'm a horrible person.
Yep.
That's why I drink.
It's true.
This could have been the end of the franchise, though.
Easily.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And we can't do that because of capitalism, and we just need to keep making movies. Right. But based on everything that we built up, and I think that's something that we'll discuss in the later couple of installments, is that there are things that happen where, like, there's absolutely no way based on what we know. And this is where it ends with Hoffman, and we know Hoffman, and we've seen this build and this build and this build, and it just doesn't make sense when they try it again.
With the final chapter?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And beyond that.
Well, what works with this one is you also had a line in the past of Amanda asking Hoffman when his trap is. And
right.
I do believe we saw his original trap in 5. Where John sat him down and did the shotgun thing to him, right?
Yes.
Because John learned that he was copycatting.
Yes, but he never got, like, did anything to get out of that trap.
No, he was being tested to be asked if he would come aboard and do things properly.
Yes.
Right. So with that line, it makes sense why this should end the Hoffman trilogy of him finally getting tested.
Right.
You know, you had 3 is Amanda's movie. I don't want to do this. Never mind.
It's gonna get bad.
Yeah,
we don't know.
Right.
But let's just get to the point real quick.
Yes.
That's what happens at the end.
Yes.
With him, with Jill putting the trap on his head.
Right.
Which, again, as she said, could be the perfect ending for the franchise.
Yes.
Ultimately, because, like, he gets to come up and. Because, you know, he's been the bad guy for all these films.
Right, exactly.
I mean, granted, there were still probably some things that they left dangling just in case they wanted to do a 7th one.
Well, him being
which
alive.
Which they end up doing it. Right. Well, yeah. But that was a very good conclusion to that.
Truly. Great ending shot, too.
But, like, to go back to the traps and everything else.
Yes.
I mean, it was an interesting dynamic because, like, it was different, like, different people he worked with.
Yes.
Although it was a weird, strange thing because you go into the whole Jigsaw philosophy, you still had these people dying.
Right,
Now, some of these people had no chance.
No.
Like, that janitor that he was with, It's like, oh, you're dying or he's dying.
Yeah,
it's like, what's, you know, I guess that's where Hoffman comes into play more, because Hoffman doesn't give a shit. You know?
Right.
Like that whole, you know, what's that? That ride with the circular ride?
Carousel.
Yes. Is that what you call it? Yeah. Yep. Yeah, with the shotgun carousel.
Oh, so good.
I mean, such a great segment.
Yeah.
Right.
But four of those people are dying.
Right.
You know, those, and they didn't do anything wrong.
No.
Right. Right.
They just happen to work for this company.
So there's the difference in philosophy with Hoffman and Jigsaw for sure.
Yes.
Yeah. That's what I really love about this also with the traps in this movie. Everybody taken is all from the same insurance company.
Mm-hmm.
So like it like everybody you met in this one building is who you're seeing later,
right,
in every single scenario, which like that's...
It makes it more intimate for sure.
Definitely. Which makes everything feel more emotionally connected for this protagonist who has to constantly be faced with people, not like in three where he's being faced with people he's never met before, never known, didn't know anything about them, you know, and just immediately seeing them being painted as villains.
Yeah.
This, he's seeing people he constantly knows who he has to care for and protect.
Yeah.
Which and most of them work really well.
Yeah, and most of them are like trying to convince him why he should let them live.
Yeah. Oh, and there's some great fucking traps in this movie. We talked about the shotgun carousel, which is like the go home as far as traps go.
Right.
And it's so good. He has to pick four people to live, right?
Well, he chooses two people to survive.
To survive. And then what?
The other four get shot.
Yeah, four get shot. So he chooses who lives and who dies.
Which is a good commentary on the whole message that it's trying to send.
Definitely. Yeah. Well, yeah, going along with his entire... what he said, he had a system on choosing who lives and who dies.
Right.
As the healthcare provider.
Well, that was the message there.
Right, you know? Right. Yes. So, yeah, that's great. Then you have, like, he has to burn himself to get somebody through, like, a rat maze, which is great, so that she can get the cheese at the end, but then she has to fucking kill him anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. What are some other traps in this one?
The one with the older woman and the younger person, right? Right.
Somebody gets strung up and somebody...
They're both hanging up. They're both, like, had nooses around their neck.
Yeah, it was like barbed wire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's weird that it takes this long for me to think this is the trap movie.
Mm.
Like, they set that up beforehand, but I feel like this is the movie where it really comes into its own with the creativity of the traps.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, six is surprisingly good after four and five.
Right? And who, like, especially since, like, especially with franchises... When is, like, the sixth movie ever good?
Right.
Anywhere? Never.
That never happens ever.
Friday the 13th, part six. But I digress.
Okay.
But
which
still,
one
like,
is that?
That's Jason Lives with Tommy Jarvis. Camp Forest Green.
Wait, Jason Lives.
That's it's not...
Before Jason Goes to Hell.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. But after Chris Benoit.
So Jason Lives... Is that...
Yes.
Yes.
it's the third one in the Tommy Jarvis trilogy.
Right.
Yes.
Is that the one with the mutant, like, kinetic powers?
No, that's seven.
Okay.
That's the psychic, the Jason versus Carrie type movie.
Right.
That's seven.
Right. Okay.
No, this is six. It's basically they change the camp to Camp Forest Green and he tries to come back to burn Jason in his grave.
Right.
And
okay,
he pokes the metal post into it and it gets struck by lightning.
Yeah.
So it becomes zombie Jason for the first time.
Right.
It's one of my favorites.
Okay.
So I had to note there. Sorry I ranted.
No.
But you rarely see like later entries like that be like very highly regarded in terms of series.
Yeah, no, Freddy's Dead is terrible. I can't
curse,
think of any
curse of Michael Myers.
Oof.
Oh, we don't
even
talk about
the director's cut's okay. Tops.
No, nope,
but not great.
Stop it. We don't talk about that.
He's got a good mask.
It's the only thing I can say about that movie.
It's got a good mask.
It has a good mask.
It does. And Paul Rudd.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Michael Myers bleeds green.
Yes.
I think the only thing that we can say is that Busta Rhymes killed Michael Myers and he can never come back. Ever. He can never come back.
Oh, man. I saw that in theaters and just left so disappointed. Ugh. Yeah. Busta Rhymes with a stick.
No, he killed him.
Yeah.
You know, he can never come back.
He killed him.
Like a mop.
He never threw teeth in a bathroom or any
no, of those no, things. Not at all.
He killed never his, did that.
He killed his dignity and pride.
He never sure. just left a baby in a crib and then yeah, didn't off. Stab it. He right. didn't do any of that.
All right, so going back, that is correct. I really can't think of any other sick like franchise six movies that.
Well, doesn't this like, reach necessarily have to be a six one? But I'm talking right. about like,
but like that late, late, that late in the game, franchise.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, to reach its stride like that, yeah, where they finally figure out how to put place all the pieces together, where something flows way more naturally.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's very,
which is why surprising. It's so disappointing. It kind of falls apart after yeah. this.
Unfortunately, yes. All the traps are great in this. The blood, the gore, all that, all practical effects look great. Story told wonderfully. One of my favorites to rewatch easily. Just a lot of fun. Saw six, guys. Good acting by everybody involved, right?
Yeah. No, I yeah. didn't have any problems with
no
that.
No problems.
No.
Yeah.
There you go. Saw six.
Good time.
Great time. Highly recommend.
What is this?
It's a game.